history of musical minimalism has been dominated by straight white men. Steve Reich, Philip Glass, John Adams, Terry Riley, Lamont Young. Although they achieved and continue to achieve excellence in the classical music world, bridging the gap between elite art forms and popular styles, minimalism was also an important vehicle for people who do not identify as a straight white man to express the unexpressible through music. Specifically, the tradition of post-minimalism, which is the generation of minimalism in the 1970s and 80s after the first initial experiments were conducted, allowed for a combination of stripped-down textures, large-scale forms, and improvisatory practices. This generation of post-minimalism is almost monumental in scope. Pieces of music last anywhere between 30 minutes and an hour and a half. Composers also started to transition into multidisciplinary platforms, being also filmmakers, choreographers, and performing musicians. So minimalism transcended those early experiments of tape looping and phasing conducted by Steve Reich, and became an important vehicle for expressing identities that did not have a voice in traditional vocabularies of classical music. Julius Eastman is a figure who is still very misunderstood. In fact, his music is only now being recovered and recorded in the last decade or so. Eastman was a pianist and vocalist who studied at the Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia and later moved to Buffalo, collaborating extensively with the Buffalo Philharmonic as well as other classical music organizations around the United States. Eventually, in the 1970s, Eastman moves to East Village, New York City, where he becomes involved in the downtown music scene, composing minimalist music, performing as an improviser, as a jazz musician, and famously as a vocalist. He was actually a very known figure in the world of classical vocal music, recording some famous compositions by Peter Maxwell Davies, for example. Yet for a variety of reasons, by the 1980s, Eastman struggled to pave a career. He tried to get a tenure-track position at Cornell. He's from Ithaca, New York, by the way, and he was not able to. And other opportunities dried up, so he eventually kind of disappeared after being evicted out of his apartment in East Village, New York, moved up to Buffalo, where he passed away from cardiac arrest in 1990, and none of the classical community actually knew about his death until almost a year later. So his music is still shrouded in mystery and a struggle to express himself. Luckily, he was very vocal about his style and the types of ambitions that he sought in his music. He described his music as minimal in form, maximal in effect. Eastman's music is post-minimalism to a great degree. These pieces are no shorter than 30 minutes in length, featuring numerous instruments and featuring elements of jazz improvisation, pop music, as well as chance procedures and sections that are meant to be improvised. Often did not specify the instrumentation, which is something that composers like Louis Andriessen, another famous post-minimalist composer, also practiced. This is the tradition of Terry Riley's In C, to leave the actual compositional forces up to the context. This was a statement about musical democracy. This kind of music could, in theory, be performed by anybody, and that was exactly the point. Eastman had a difficult relationship between his uptown credentials as a classically trained pianist, vocalist, and composer, and his downtown identity. This is evidenced by the fact that he collaborated with members of both the uptown scene and the downtown scene. He worked extensively with Lucas Foss, who is a uptown composer, if there ever was one, as well as with Meredith Monk, an interdisciplinary performance artist who we'll actually talk about later in this lecture. Eastman had a mantra, and I think this mantra really applies to some of his more politically charged compositions of the late 1970s and early 1980s. These pieces often had very provocative titles that were meant to depict some kind of an internal turmoil or some kind of protest against society. So he once wrote that, "What I am trying to achieve is to be what I am to the fullest, black to the fullest, a musician to the fullest, a homosexual to the fullest." As with any music that doesn't have text to it, it's very difficult to interpret some of these compositions as being reflections of his own personality or if they were simply part of his compositional style. This is a task that all classical music gives us. How do we read a composer's biography into a composition? We've seen a similar situation with Beethoven's heroic style. In a way, Eastman's music is positioned today as a heroic period, just like Beethoven's Eroica Symphony, for example, was said to channel his internal struggle. So we know not to read instrumental music too literally, but at the same time, when a composer leaves a documentary evidence of what he was trying to achieve, it's difficult to separate the composer from the composition. Specifically with works titled Gay Guerrilla. Guerrilla here obviously means a kind of a protest militia. The title suggests that Eastman is trying to fight his way through discrimination and through struggle in his personal and professional life. Gay Guerrilla is written for four of any instrument. Most traditionally, it's performed for four pianos. Like a lot of Eastman's music from the late 1970s, it begins with a very simple vamp or some kind of a minimalist pattern that each of the four instruments, in this case four pianos, start repeating over and over. Here he combines Western-style staff notation with time notation, meaning that although there is rhythm and meter in the traditional sense, he is also indicating how many minutes in terms of clock time every instrumentalist is supposed to hold a particular pattern. Performances of Gay Guerrilla in particular are widely different because people do very different things within these time spans, play slowly, play fast, play loud. Generally in Gay Guerrilla, there is a trajectory where it starts very soft and then eventually it grows to an aggressive, almost violent type of dynamic, only to kind of die down over a very, very gradual period of time. So minimalist procedures are definitely in place here. Eastman described his music as organic music. This is a term that is similar to Philip Glass's idea of additive process, meaning that a single idea starts getting developed and expanded through minimalist and improvisatory procedures until it swells and then goes back down. Here, Eastman is clearly also drawing on a 19th century tradition of motivic development. Think of Brahms, for example. The difference here is that Eastman built a certain amount of improvisation into each of his compositions. Another element that is important in Gay Guerrilla in particular is his use of the Lutheran church hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. We're going to listen to the opening minutes of Gay Guerrilla, and then I'm going to skip forward, and you'll hear that presentation of the hymn. Think about what he's trying to do with that hymn, and what exactly that hymn is doing for him as a character in his own composition. going to skip ahead now to when you start hearing the Lutheran hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Pay attention to how Eastman's organic principle starts unfolding as the music gets angrier and more assertive, and when the hymn fully starts emerging as a melody. It's pretty easy to call Eastman's music avant-garde. After all, he is breaking a lot of rules of traditional composition, allowing for improvisation and chance procedures and a minimalist sense of control to come together in this monumental 30-minute composition, which will never sound the same way twice. What minimalism provides here is a sense of artistic freedom. I think that Eastman and Meredith Monk, as we will see, are both after the same thing. A sense of freedom as an artist, a sense of breaking away from what is expected of them as either a classically trained composer who has to compose in a serialist, advanced, very difficult style, and on the other hand, a commercial, popular artist who has to satisfy a status quo. Post-minimalism was able to bridge that gap between high and low styles and really create a place where people whose voices have not been traditionally heard can express themselves as loudly and aggressively as they want. This sense of freedom of expression is clear in Meredith Monk's very diverse body of work. Monk is not just a composer, she is a vocalist, performance artist, director, and choreographer. In fact, she is best known for her multidisciplinary works, which combine pop and experimental music with film and with concept album types of organizations. She's also very well known for her extended vocal techniques, which means that she explores different ways of singing beyond the traditional operatic sound and the emerging popular sound. She plays with childlike sound effects, with kind of disturbing noises, with different types of vocal manipulations. Other female composers and artists also played around with the voice as being something more than just a vehicle for traditional musical expression. Artists like Laurie Anderson, Diamanda Galás, and Björk have all and continue to bridge that gap between pop music and experimental music, bringing new ways of producing vocal sound and new ways of identifying as a female composer. Similarly to Steve Reich and Philip Glass, Meredith Monk tours with her own ensemble. This is actually pretty common in the minimalist and post-minimalist tradition to start your own ensemble, because these composers have such different perspectives on music that they're able to kind of compose for one another. Although Monk is best known for her experimental films and concept albums, she also did and continues to compose in traditional classical styles like opera and string quartet. We're going to look at one of her most famous films and albums, Turtle Dreams. Now, the premise is pretty simple. Monk imagines the dreams of her pet turtle. This seems juvenile and strange, but again, that's exactly the point. Her conception of art is to create an extreme direct simplicity and to not feel hindered by any prejudices of maturity, of seriousness, of profundity. To really have a voice as an artist, Monk wanted to create a brand new voice and a brand new aesthetic. This is also the 1980s, so her film also resembles Some of the rock groups of the time, I'm thinking of Pink Floyd or the Talking Heads, for example, and you may notice some resonances with some of that 80s rock music. There's also an element of the German band Kraftwerk in here, combining organ, electronics, and kind of robotic approaches to the body to create something that's a little bit unsettling, but also funny and creates a different type of sensation than what came before. Turtle Dreams is based on a pretty simple organ chord progression, which is actually performed by Julius Eastman on the original track. As the organ progression continues to repeat, the four people on the screen start dancing in sync and then start breaking and singing different types of music and different types of styles. There's a sense of polyphony here. I want you to think about the degree of seriousness as an artwork that is being portrayed here. What do you make of Turtle Dreams as a serious art form? Is seriousness even the point here? I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments if you've experienced anything like this. Here is Turtle Dreams by Meredith Monk. To composers who are still alive today, or whose lives were tragically cut short, like Julius Eastman's, minimalism meant freedom. It meant freedom from the very strict rules of serialism, which were as strict as counterpoint was in the 18th century. There were different paths to success that were emerging in the 1970s and 80s. Paths that did not require the approval of white men in suits. This was precisely why Julius Eastman and Meredith Monk went in very different directions in terms of how to apply traditional classical compositional styles with more improvisatory, freeing types of expression. They were not shy about their bodies and their identities. In fact, they confronted them and they projected them through their art. If there is a sense of childlike simplicity in Turtle Dreams, that almost displays a level of comfort on the part of Meredith Monk. And that, to me, means good art. Likewise, with Julius Eastman, there's a level of anger that's portrayed in his music. It is not anger that is traditionally thought of in classical music. It's not a minor scale melody in the style of a Mozart movement, for example, but that was a very different approach to anger. What Mozart was doing was channeling what was universally thought of as anger and representing it through mimesis. What Eastman was doing was pouring his entire compositional personality into this improvisatory vessel. In a way, he was able to create a safe space for himself in his compositions. So as we have seen with post-minimalism, although they broke with some of the seriousness and complexity of serial avant-garde music, at the same time, they were also after a very similar ambition, and that's to create a place for artistic freedom. Thank you for listening, and I look forward to speaking to you again soon.